Ibu Bapak, adik Mahal, good morning Joy. Sorry to make you wake up this early. It's 9 o'clock there, right?
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah. So welcome everyone to PKBB webinar. And the theme for our event today is finding publications and managing references. And on behalf of PKBB, I would like to thank Joy Lofstrand and Gede Primahadi Wijaya Rajab for agreeing to give a talk in this event. I would also like to thank Ibu Katarina Sukamto, who is willing to chair this session. Last but not least, of course, I would like to thank participants who already registered for this event. It was really surprising that we had almost 300 people. For some of us, it might have been difficult to accept the fact that we attend an event like this by sitting in front of our computers in our rooms, right? However, this seems to be a common practice now. Of course, I would like to thank participants who already registered. What I think is good about virtual meetings like this is that we can host an event with large crowds like today. However, since this meeting is very crowded, I hope everyone can mute their microphones, especially during the presentations. And for the presentation and QA mechanism, please follow Ibu Katrin's instruction later on. And to make sure that this event goes smoothly, I hope that everyone pays attention to the rules that we have sent you a few days ago. And again, I thank Joy and Gede. Without further ado, I will now let Ibu Katrin start the event. Please move.
Okay, thank you, Ibu Yanti. Good morning, Joy.
Good morning.
Good afternoon, Gede and all participants. Welcome to our webinar today with the topic Finding Publications and Managing References. We are honored to have our two young, energetic scholars here, Joy and Gede. Well, let me read a brief bio data of the two speakers. Joseph Lofstrand obtained his PhD in linguistics from Oxford University in 2018. He is now a British Academy postdoctoral fellow at SOAS University, SOAS in London. Welcome, Joy. And the second speaker is Gede Primahadi Wijaya Rajab, who completed his PhD in linguistics at Monash University, Australia in 2019. He is currently a lecturer at Udayana University in Bali. Well, without further ado, I would like to invite the first speaker, Joy. You start? Yeah, you can start now. Okay.
Yeah, so I'll start in English, but Gede will also add information in Indonesian. So if anyone has trouble understanding my English, don't worry, there's going to be Indonesian as well. So hopefully everyone will benefit from this time together. So let me first also say thank you to Yanti and PKBB and Ibu Katarina for organizing this event and creating these opportunities and platforms for people to share ideas and tips and tools. Always appreciated working with Alpanjaya PKBB, and it's another great opportunity to do that. Hope this is useful for all the participants. We're going to just talk about some of the technical aspects of managing a reference list when you're working as a researcher. So, you know, the basic idea is that research is going to involve looking at original articles that are published, and you need to be able to interact with those in the writing. And we wanted to help take away all of the technical difficulties in managing that so that you can really focus on the content of what you're reading and what you want to interact with. So let me share my screen. Let's see if this works. So let's say you wanted to do research in linguistics. Can everyone see the screen?
Yep.
Okay. So let's say you want to do research on Indonesian pronouns. And so you go to Google and you look for Indonesian pronouns. What you're going to find is a lot of very basic information, repeating the same sort of introductory information about pronouns. And so most people already know that if you go to scholar.google.com, you come up with a different search interface. And this one is limited to articles, academic publications, books, and the kind of research information that you need. If I search for Indonesian pronouns here, I end up with a list of only information from published sort of academic resources. And so I can go through this list and look for something that's interesting to the kind of research that I want to do. So let's say that I'm interested in this kind of a topic on how people use different pronouns in their speech in Indonesian. Thankfully, this is an article that has a link to a PDF. So not every article has a PDF, but the ones that do will have a link to a PDF. So can check out this article. One thing I want to mention that is that as a researcher, you spend a lot of time reading, and reading articles is always difficult, time-consuming, and mentally draining. So you can't read everything, but you have to look at articles and decide which ones you want to read. Of course, a very good way to decide what to read is to look at the abstract. So this one right in the beginning tells us that it's going to be about colloquial Indonesian and the two pronouns, kamu and elu. Okay, so that gives me an idea. Another way that I would recommend for deciding if you want to read an article is to go all the way down to the end of the article to the conclusion. So academic articles are not like novels or stories. There's no spoilers. You can go straight to the end and see what the ending is, and that should tell you whether or not you want to invest your time in reading this article based on what it says in the conclusion. So this gives a very good summary of the content of the article. With longer articles, I might also recommend going through the table of contents. So before you try to sit down and read the whole article, just read the table of contents. So this one has an introduction. As an introduction to an overview of colloquial Indonesian, so I know it's going to be specifically about colloquial Indonesian, and it's going to be explained in this section. There's going to be another section about style and term shifting, so I know that this is the section where the author is going to present her definitions, her terminology, or the concept that she's applying. And then there's going to be another section, Kamu, Alu, and Diglosia, so this is going to be more information specifically about these pronouns and what's been said about them. And then I can see a section called Dese ada apa dan cinta. So this is going to be the first case study in this article. And then there's a section called Eiffel, and this is going to be the second case study about this novel called Eiffel. And then there's a conclusion. So without reading this article, with spending just 5 minutes looking at it, I have a very good idea what the content is, how it's structured, and whether this is going to be helpful to me in my research. So I think that's just a good approach to decide how to filter which articles you want to read and which one you shouldn't spend your time on. So let's say we've studied this article and I want to find more. I think everybody knows that an article will often cite other work. And so in the context, for example, this article cites James Nedda, 2002, in reference to how what's been said about these pronouns in the past. So of course I can go to the bibliography. Klein said in 2002. Since I have a PDF, I can just copy this. And I can go back to Google Scholar and search for this article. Unfortunately, this is an article that doesn't have any links online. It's not available. But that doesn't mean that Google Scholar is not helpful, and I'll show you why in just a moment. Another thing that Google Scholar does that it's really helpful for is it tells you not just what articles did this article cite, so what work was done previous to this article, but it tells you which articles cited this article that you're interested in. So it tells you what is the future, what's the ongoing conversation about this topic. So that's this down here, this cited by. So these articles all have a cited by and a number. And you can click on that, and it's going to show you 28 other books or publications or articles that cited that previous article. So that's going to give you an idea of which other authors are interacting with this work. So you can do the same thing with these, scroll through your titles and see, here's one about variation, what kind of thing I'm interested in. So I can click on this article by this author in the hands. And luckily again, this one is available online, and you can go through the same process of looking at the abstract and also just search to see where does this person cite journal. There's one citation here. And so I can see what are the areas where this person is interacting with the author that I was just reading. And of course, you can continue to follow the path. So I know that this person cited the article I'm interested in. I can follow, okay, well, who cited this person? You can go even more. And by doing this, you can build up the whole network of publications and articles that are citing each other and talking about each other's work, so that you can get a sort of a holistic picture of who is involved. Even with an article like this one that's not available online, I can still see who cited this article. So I can see what other people are talking about this article and use that as a way to find information. I'll just say one other tip about finding articles, you can also click on, some authors have a Google Scholar page, and so you can click on their name. It will show you their page and a list of all of their publications, with links to where you might find it online. So you can always use that. And then of course you can always just look for, if there's an author whose work you're very interested in, you can always just search for them. And if they have a professional webpage, that webpage could, in most cases, also list their publications. So Lovely's page here has a list of all of her publications. So you can look by type or by year, you can scroll through all of her publications and see what are the other articles that she has that you might be interested in. Those are just some tips for trying to figure out how to find articles in the first place that you might be interested in reading. And then I'll hand it over to Fide to talk about how to manage those citations once you've found the articles you want to work with.
Okay, thanks, Joy. First of all, I would like to thank Joy and Buyanti and Atmajaya for inviting me to talk and share about Supiro and other stuff related to references. But this is the Awakening Day of Indonesia. It's a national day, so I will just speak in Indonesian for this meeting. I will share screen now. Saya akan share screen terlebih dahulu. Jadi saya akan melanjutkan yang Joy jelaskan. Apabila kita sudah menemukan references ataupun tulisan-tulisan yang ingin kita baca lebih lanjut, tentunya kita juga perlu mengelola tulisan itu dari segi informasi bibliografisnya, ya, penulisnya siapa, judulnya apa, kemudian tahunnya apa, karena kita mungkin akan mengutip tulisan itu nantinya ketika kita menulis. Dan biasanya mengutip itu adalah mimpi buruk bagi semua orang, mahasiswa S1, S2, S3, dan kadang-kadang dosen menghabiskan banyak waktu hanya untuk ngomongkan bibliografi daripada konten isinya. Jadi ada satu tools, satu piranti yang disebut dengan Zotero untuk mengelola semua informasi bibliografis tersebut yang semuanya free, bisa di-download secara free. Jadi saya tidak akan mencontohkan bagaimana mendownload dan menginstall di sini, tapi saya akan mengarahkan teman-teman semua ke zotero.org, kemudian ada tombol download, klik itu, dan akan diarahkan ke laman seperti ini. Jadi bisa download Zotero di komputer dan diinstall di komputer, dan juga yang paling penting adalah menginstall penghubung antara Zotero dan web browser yang kita gunakan untuk menelusuri Google Scholar, misalnya seperti yang Joe contohkan. Jadi Zotero Connector ini akan memudahkan kita untuk menyimpan secara otomatis informasi bibliografis yang kita temukan di web ke Zotero. Walaupun kita bisa melakukan secara manual, tapi saya tidak akan mencontohkan itu. Ya, jadi penting untuk menginstall kedua komponen ini. Dan saya sarankan teman-teman, Bapak Ibu semua menggunakan Chrome atau Firefox yang konektornya berfungsi dengan baik ya. Saya sudah menggunakan Zotero dari 2010 dan belum ada masalah dengan konektor tersebut di Chrome dan Firefox. Oke, anggaplah teman-teman Bapak Ibu sudah mendownload dan menginstal Zotero. Tampilan Zotero akan terlihat seperti ini. Ini adalah tampilan Zotero ya. Setelah berisi semua data artikel, buku, dan segala macam. Jadi kita bisa organize itu informasi bibliografis ini berdasarkan folder terkait topiknya misalnya.
I don't think we can see your Zotero. I think it's just sharing your browser, not your screen.
Really? Use your screen. How can I share the whole desktop? Okay, this one. Okay, Zotero. I hope everyone can see now. Mudah-mudahan semua bisa lihat. Ini Zotero, tampilan Zotero setelah kita install di komputer. Jadi ada, kita bisa organize berdasarkan topik ya. Data bibliografis itu bisa kita organize berdasarkan topik. Saya tidak akan tunjukkan itu saat ini, tapi saya akan hanya menyebutkan bahwa itu bisa. Kemudian di pojok di kanan sini kalau Bapak Ibu lihat ada informasi bibliografis yang penting ketika kita mengutip nanti ada judul, ada penulis, publikasi, nama jurnalnya, kemudian volume dan segala macam. Ini bisa kita tambahkan secara manual satu per satu di Zotero, tapi saya akan tunjukkan cara yang lebih mudah dengan saya harus kembali share Google Chrome. Okay. Anggaplah Bapak Ibu sudah menginstal Zotero di komputer dan juga sudah menginstal Zotero Connector di Chrome yang Bapak Ibu gunakan untuk menelusuri Google Scholar misalnya. Jadi saya akan melanjutkan ceritanya Joe yang mencari di Google Scholar. Ini. Kemudian kalau kita sudah menginstal Zotero Connector, teman-teman dan Bapak Ibu lihat akan lihat di pojok kanan sini ada seperti tanda folder itu kalau di Google Scholar. Ada tulisan Save to Zotero. Jadi kita bisa klik itu dan dia akan memunculkan pilihan judul yang ingin kita simpan ke Zotero. Ya, kalau tulisan yang ada di Google Scholar itu ada PDF-nya seperti ini.
That's not actually showing up either with the screen share. The pop-up doesn't show.
Oh ya. I was wondering how can I share the whole desktop. We could before during the rehearsal, but okay. Can I share the whole screen? No. Maybe this one. So let's go to it. Okay. Doesn't show up, Joe?
No, I had the same problem. I couldn't figure out where the whole screen is. Can you select that as the share option? Is just that one pop up?
Yeah, there is no share desktop saying. Okay, so, no. Maybe this one? What does it show? Can you see the...
Yeah, now it's showing R.
Can you see the Chrome now?
No, just R.
Okay. Anyway, I don't know how to share the whole desktop, by the way. So, Bapak Ibu dan teman-teman, kalau kita klik ini, yang di pojok kanan sini, nanti ada seperti pop-up window. Ada tampilan jendela yang muncul untuk bisa kita memilih semua judul yang ada di sini, yang ada di Google Scholar ini. Jadi akan ada tampilan seperti window baru di mana ada judul-judul yang bisa kita centang untuk kita download nantinya. Saya tidak ngerti kenapa ini tidak muncul semua desktop saya karena kemarin waktu rehearsal dengan Joe, I can share the whole desktop, but I don't know why. Now it doesn't work. Jadi intinya kita bisa simpan itu secara otomatis dengan mengklik ini, tombol ini, kemudian kita pilih salah satu judul di window yang keluar itu, dan kita akan lihat nanti di Zotero. Jadi saya akan menyimpan, saya akan bilang di sini, saya akan menyimpan data bibliografis dari tulisan ini, Indonesian Cross Structure from Austronesian Perspective, yang belum ada di Zotero saya. Jadi setelah ini saya akan pindah ke Windows Zotero untuk menunjukkan tampilannya. Jadi saya akan simpan itu, kemudian saya perlu ganti screen ke Zotero, share. Jadi ini dia. Mudah-mudahan Bapak Ibu teman-teman bisa lihat sudah ada Indonesian Cross Structure from Austronesian Perspective yang saya simpan dari Google Scholar tadi, dan ini dia judulnya, ada penulisnya, ada judul jurnalnya, volume isu halaman tahun dan segala macam. Oke, okay. Jadi saya kembali ke Google Chrome dan share lagi. Intinya, jadi dengan sudah menginstal konektor di Chrome, kita akan bisa dengan mudah menyimpan semua informasi bibliografis dari web. Anggaplah sekarang saya mau ke jurnal kita Linguistik Indonesia, itu misalnya, dan klik misalnya salah satu judul begini, ya. Kalau kita toleh ke pojok kanan sini, dia akan muncul lagi Save to Zotero, dan bentuknya akan berbeda seperti paper yang ada garis-garisnya. Kita bisa klik itu, dan ini kita teman-teman lihat judulnya ya, karena mungkin siapa tahu tidak muncul di Chrome sini tampilannya, Morphological Deviation. Jadi kalau kita klik ini yang pojok kanan ini, Save to Zotero, Zotero konektornya akan menyimpan data bibliografis tulisan ini di Zotero. Okay, kita kembali ke Zotero dan there we go, ini dia Morphological Deviation Produced by Nation Adolescent bla bla bla, dan sangat komplit ya, Linguistik Indonesia volume 38 URL DOI komplit. Jadi kita tidak perlu mikir masukkan itu satu-satu, tapi memang akhirnya kita perlu mengecek kembali ketika kita sudah menyimpan dari web ke Zotero, kita perlu cek kembali data bibliografis ini yang di kanan sini supaya memastikan bahwa nama penulis sudah muncul, kemudian yang lain semua sudah muncul. Sebelum saya oper ke Joe lagi, one more thing, Joe, satu lagi yang saya ingin tunjukkan, selain kita bisa menyimpan dari web, kita bisa menyimpan data bibliografis berdasarkan informasi ISBN atau DOI dari suatu tulisan atau artikel yang kita search. Jadi saya akan kembali ke Chrome. Kemudian ada buku ini misalnya, saya belum punya data bibliografisnya, jadi ada ISBN-nya, ya, ada DOI-nya. Kita bisa gunakan salah satu ini untuk menyimpan dari Zotero informasi bibliografis buku ini, Quantitative Research Methods for Linguists. Anggaplah saya akan ambil ISBN-nya, kita highlight itu, kemudian klik kanan, copy, kemudian kita kembali ke Zotero, dan kalau teman-teman lihat di sini ada seperti, saya sebut ini tongkat ajaib ya, a magic wand, add item by identifier, ya seperti tongkat ajaib, kemudian kita paste di sini ISBN atau DOI tulisan tersebut, kita tekan enter, dan teman-teman Bapak Ibu perlu internet untuk ini, kita enter dan dia akan mencari informasinya. Di sini sudah disimpan judul, penulis, tempat, publisher, dan tahun. Ya, saya tidak bisa membayangkan kalau saya tidak menggunakan tool ini untuk menulis artikel ataupun thesis. Saya pikir sudah sekian, and I think I'm done with this, Joe, for showing how they can, save their bibliographic information. So, Joe.
Okay, let me see if we're not going to have any problems with this screen share. Uday, can you see the pop-up window or no? You're on mute. Can you unmute? I can't hear you. There's no pop-up window?
No. What we did during the rehearsal is that we can scrap the whole desktop.
Yeah, that doesn't. And now you don't see the Zotero window at all?
No.
Okay, this is going to be difficult. Maybe there's some settings from PKBB that would allow us to share the whole screen. Because on this call, we can't share the whole screen. We can only share one thing at a time. I don't have an option to share the whole screen either. It's the same problem.
Let me try to. I'll try to do some screenshots.
Can you see the pop-up window now or no?
Yep.
Now you can see it, but you can't see Word?
Yeah, no. But I think this is okay.
Okay, maybe I'll go back and forth a bit too.
Yeah.
Try to make this worse. Sorry to everyone that this technical problem is not allowing us to share screens in the way we wanted to. Okay, so let's say you're going to write a document using Word. So you're typing up your information and you want to add some citations and you also want a list of references for everyone that you cite. If you try to do this by hand, of course, you know, there's a danger that you'll make mistakes or that you'll forget to put something in and it can be very time consuming. So this is not a good idea for you just to try to type everything yourself. That's why you have a database. What the database allows you to do. Is to so you need to, in order to do this, you'll need to install a plugin for Word or OpenOffice or whatever program you're using. And we'll send you a link for doing that. But the basic idea is that when you come into Word or whatever you're using, there'll be an option for Zotero. And there'll be special buttons here that are created for you to work with Zotero. So if in this position I want to add a citation, you can just click the button that says Add or Edit Citation. And what shows up is this kind of a bar. This bar then will allow you to search your entire Zotero database for any information. So if I wanted to cite something by Erica, I can just put it in the name. It's going to automatically give me everything in my bibliography that has those letters in there. So let's say it's this one that I want to cite. So I can click on that one and I can press enter. Go back to sharing my Word. Now in Word, you can see that it's automatically entered that paper. And if it's not just one, you can actually put in several. You can click on your citation again and see that it's grayed out. Click on Add or Edit Citation again. Now you can add more citations. Word. You can see now that there's several citations there from the same author with all the years. You notice that it also put in A and B for you automatically as well. Now I don't have to type in the references. I can just click on add bibliography. And all of those that I selected will show up here in Word automatically. It also allows you to do some other options with this work. So sometimes you don't want to put the name in the abbreviation because you're referring to it in a different way. You can, so you can select your work. You don't have to search by author, actually. You can also search by anything that's in the title. So you can search by any word that's in the title or any word that's in the book. So if I search for the name of this language, it also shows me this information. And then after you select, you can modify it. So there's a few options here. You can add a page number. This is page number 58 that I want to cite. And you can also remove the author's name in cases where you don't want the author inside the paragraph. So that's this button, suppress author. If I select that, go back to sharing Word with you. And the Word document now has this entry. It has name and page number. Another great thing about Zotero is that it handles different styles for you. So if you realize that this is not the right format for your bibliography, you can just click on Document Preferences. And I will show you this window. So there's a whole list of different styles that you can use to select your different kind of options. So this is APA, most of you have heard of. Chicago, MLA is here. I normally use this one, United Style Sheet for Linguistics. If I click on that, if I go back to the Word document, you can now see that the style has changed. There's no more comma. Now it's using colons instead of comma, and the way the bibliography look has changed as well. So you can automatically update to whatever style you want to use. So this is where your Zotero database is really helpful, because when you're writing a document, you don't have to do this yourself. You can just access your database. Of course, your database has to be correct. If information from your database is wrong, it's going to be wrong here. It's important, maybe one final thing, is not to make changes here. So if you try to change the way this looks here and try to take something out, as soon as you refresh, it comes back in. So this is going to automatically check this out. So don't make changes here. Make changes in your database if you need to make corrections. So that's how you can use your Zotero database with Word. And we've also sent out some links for tutorials on how to use that. But everybody should know that this is probably the best way for you to use citations if you're working with a word processor like Word or OpenOffice. Not everyone is going to be using Word or OpenOffice, even though most people will. So we're going to talk about two other types of programs that you could use to format your work. One that I'll talk about first is called LaTeX. So this is an example of a LaTeX document, which looks very complicated, and we're not going to explain how to use LaTeX. I'll just maybe say a few things about why you might want to consider using LaTeX, and then show you that it is possible to connect your Zotero database with LaTeX as well. And then today we'll share about RMark notebook. So LaTeX is useful for a few reasons. One is that it can create more professional looking documents. So for the kind of linguistics I do, I'm also often using interlinearized examples with multiple languages. And so this is difficult to do in Word, but quite simple to do in LaTeX. LaTeX also allows me to create the kind of charts and graphs that look more professional, which would be also quite difficult to do in Word. LaTeX is not easy to learn. So it's not for everyone, only if you really need it and have the time to learn it. Another great thing about LaTeX is that if you're working with a large document, you know, if you're writing your dissertation and it's going to be over 100,000 words, sometimes Word and those programs will struggle with a document of that size. So LaTeX has no problem with a large file, so it can be very useful for writing very large works. I'll show you how LaTeX looks using an online version that's easier to access. That's this one called overleaf.com. So at overleaf.com, you can access a LaTeX processor in a fairly easy way. Of course, you need internet access. But the idea here is that on this side of the screen, you can enter in your text. And then that information becomes compiled on the right side, and it creates a PDF that has your information there in the text. So if you're writing in this way, how do you do citations? Again, you don't want to do it manually, but you can. You can't use your Zotero plugin, but there is still a way to use your Zotero database to get the information. So in this kind of format, what you need for citations is you need to be able to have a information in a it's called a BibTeX format, B-I-B-T-E-X. This is a format that works with other kinds of word processors. So you can see this, maybe it looks complicated, but it's basically the same information that goes into a Zotero database. You have your title, equal marks and these curly brackets in the title. You have the author, the year, publisher. So it's all the same information that would show up in a Zotero database. It's just in a different format. So how do you get it into this format? There's a few ways to do this. So this is my Zotero, what it looks like in a PC. So probably the easiest way to get it in that format is just to say, select the articles that you want to cite. And if you right click, you can export items. Then it'll ask you what format you want your export to be. There's a bunch of different options, and these are all created so that you can work with other kinds of bibliographic referencing information. I'm using one I downloaded called Better BibTeX, which gives you very good formatting, making some changes that are needed for working in LaTeX. So I click OK. It'll ask me where I want to save this file, so I can just save it anywhere. And then if I look at that file, the same information now that I took from Zotero is here in the BibTeX format. So what I need to do is copy this information, go back to my LaTeX. So in LaTeX, I have the main text, but I also have another file. And this file is called a .bib file, .bib. And this is the file where I need to store information that's going to be in the BibTeX format. So I can store this information here in the file. Now from the main text, I can access that file. So instead of writing out who I want to cite, put in a code, and that gives me a list of names that are in my file. So I wanted to cite this paper by Arca, and I also wanted to cite Haskell map. Well, I can select names. So these names, like ARCA 2018, are in this file, ARCA 2018. And this name, Haskell map defining versus diagnosing, this is one of the ones I just copied in. So it's here in this file. And so in the main text, once I put in this code, it will read what's in the bibliography file. And when I compile, now going to give me the references here that I wanted. 2018, 2015. And it can also fill in automatically my list of references, just like it did in Word. And that's because of some other code I have here that tells it where the bibliography is. And so it uses this information to find this name in this file, and then it gives me the list. And there's other ways to change the formatting. It can be a bit more complex, so we won't get into the details. This is just so that you know that this is another option for how you can format your articles and how you can use the information from Zotero to do that. I mentioned one thing before I go back to today, is that there is a way to create on your computer a .bib file that automatically updates and stays synced with your Zotero document. So the idea is you have a Zotero database that has all of your bibliographic information. You have an exact copy of that information in a .bib file that you can use for LaTeX. And those two will always be updating, so that if you make a change in the .bib file, it changes the database. If you make a change in the database, it changes your .bib file. So the way that's done is you would have to export basically everything or everything that you want to have in this file. Again, into Better BibTeX, and then you would just click this button, Keep Updated. And Keep Updated is going to be the part that's going to do that, that syncing, so that those files can interact with each other. If you modify one, you'll modify the other, but I won't demonstrate how that's done. So I'll just stop there and give it back to Dave.
Thank Joy. Baik, Bapak Ibu, teman-teman. Tadi Joy sudah menunjukkan bagaimana kita bisa memasukkan sitiran ke Word setelah kita ada database Zotero-nya, dan juga bagaimana kita bisa membuat daftar pustaka di Word yang akan otomatis terupdate ketika kita menambahkan sitiran baru, dia akan otomatis Word mengupdate bibliografi kita di Word. Jadi tidak ada pain, tidak ada sakit hati nanti ketika ada sitiran yang tidak bisa kita kutip atau kelewatan dikutip. Kemudian tadi juga Joy sudah menunjukkan cara lain untuk membuat dokumen dengan LaTeX, dan juga bisa berinteraksi dengan informasi bibliografis dari Zotero untuk menulis artikel di LaTeX. Yang saya akan contohkan saat ini adalah karena kita juga bisa membuat dokumen untuk nanti diekspor ke dalam format Word di R. Some question asking about, you know, which one is better, Zotero or Mendeley, but we can talk about that later on. Jadi saya akan contohkan bagaimana kita bisa menulis atau membuat dokumen di R. Jadi saya akan share screen dulu. Dan akan menjelaskan sedikit apa itu R, hanya overview saja. Jadi R itu adalah bahasa pemrograman untuk analisis statistik dan visualisasi ide dasar, tapi Bapak Ibu bisa menggunakan R untuk memproses teks, membuat website, mengunduh file dari internet, apapun. Jadi luar biasa. Kemudian learning curve-nya, kurva pembelajaran untuk R itu cukup terjal. Jadi harus diakui memang cukup lamanya. Jadi saya mulai belajar 2011 dan mulai nyaman setelah 6 tahun belajar. Jadi tapi it's worth it, jadi yang kita dapat akan sangat bermanfaat. Jadi ada R yang free tentunya, kemudian juga ada R Studio di mana kita akan membuat dokumen di dalam R menggunakan R Studio. Dan di R Studio ini ada fitur yang dikenal dengan R Notebook untuk kita bisa membuat dokumen yang saya akan contohkan nanti tampilannya, yang kita bisa menggabungkan teks biasa, satu teks biasa narasi kita ya. Kemudian kita bisa menggabungkan code pemrograman R yang berisi semua tahapan ketika kita melakukan analisis kuantitatif dan menggabungkan luaran dari code tersebut. Misalnya Bapak Ibu melakukan data visualisasi, Bapak Ibu punya code-nya, jadi di bawah code itu akan ada hasil ya. Jadi inti dari R Markdown itu adalah kita bisa menghasilkan dokumen yang disebut dengan reproducible document. Jadi state of the art modern science salah satunya adalah riset itu bisa reproducible, jadi orang lain bisa menghasilkan kembali apa yang kita buat, karena kita perlu juga men-share data kita, code semuanya di-share sehingga orang lain bisa verify memverifikasi apa yang kita katakan di artikel tersebut. Dan memang R Markdown ini ada, saya tampilkan saja dulu modelnya. Ya. Jadi memang ada kelebihan dan kekurangannya ya. Misalnya R Markdown tidak bisa, belum ada fitur di R Markdown untuk membuat interlinear glossing seperti di LaTeX. Kemudian itu saja yang saya lihat belum ada ya. Tapi ini juga tergantung tujuan kita masing-masing membuat dokumen seperti Joy, dia perlu buat diagram LFG itu yang mungkin memudahkan itu terjadi di LaTeX. Sedangkan goal saya adalah saya ingin dokumen saya atau makalah saya bersifat reproducible, semua tahapan saya bisa ingat kembali ya, dan juga orang lain bisa menciptakan kembali apa yang saya hasilkan di makalah tersebut. Jadi ini tampilan RStudio. Jadi teman-teman perlu menginstall R, RStudio, kemudian juga perlu belajar bagaimana coding di R, jadi kita tidak akan membahas itu. Ini dia tampilannya ketika kita sudah bekerja di RStudio. Dan ini filenya disebut R Markdown Notebook, di mana kita sekilas ya ada teks biasa, dan tentunya formatting di R Notebook, R Markdown Notebook ini berbeda dengan di Word. Jadi misalnya ini akan menghasilkan garis miring nanti di Word, ya ini akan menghasilkan sesuatu yang bisa diklik di Word ya, kayak cross referencing, dan itu teks biasanya dan beragam formattingnya. Kemudian ada juga code pemrogramannya ya, jadi menjadi satu di file itu, dan luaran dari code ini. Jadi kedepannya kita di masa depan itu kita tidak akan lupa terkait gimana kita menghasilkan tabel ini. Apa tahap-tahap yang kita lakukan. Jadi itu ide reproducible document. Ini memang perlu waktu. Dan tentunya juga ketika kita membuat artikel di R Markdown Notebook ini, kita bisa mengutip juga misalnya seperti ini. Yang saya akan tunjukkan adalah bagaimana kita bisa berinteraksi antara informasi bibliografis ke R Markdown Notebook ketika kita membuat dokumen di R Markdown Notebook. Jadi misalnya kalau kita kita jalankan semua code yang ada di dalam R Markdown ini, R Markdown-nya akan bekerja, R-nya akan bekerja selama kita membagikan untuk orang lain nantinya secara terbuka semua code, data, dan file lain yang terkait di sana ya. Jadi bisa kita preview tampilannya, misalnya seperti ini. Jadi ini adalah makalah begitu ya, yang dibuat di R. Jadi semua ada di sini, tabel, kemudian ada luaran statistik, kemudian ada code-nya. Ya ini adalah preview dari notebook di HTML, dan kita tentunya juga bisa meng-outputnya ke dalam bentuk Word. Misalnya begitu, jadi R Markdown akan mengekspor. R akan mengekspor R Markdown Notebook ini ke dalam format Word yang nantinya bisa kita submit ke R Journal. Tapi tentunya memang saya akan share Microsoft Word. Tapi memang tentunya kalau kita ada glossing misalnya seperti contoh di sini, saya perlu menyiapkan contoh lain, dokumen lain di Word hanya untuk contohnya saja. Karena memang R Markdown Notebook belum saya tahu ada orang yang membuat code untuk bisa membuat example dan interlinear glossing. Oke. Okay. Jadi itu idenya. Sekarang saya akan contohkan bagaimana kita memasukkan bibliografi di R Notebook. Oke. Okay. Anggaplah begini. Ini R Notebook yang sederhana. Kemudian tadi Joe sudah menunjukkan bagaimana kita bisa mengekspor informasi bibliografis ke dalam format BibTeX seperti ini. Ya, mudah-mudahan Bapak Ibu teman-teman masih ingat tampilannya persis seperti ini. Ya, dan file ini harus berada di satu folder dengan notebook kita ya. Jadi file referensi.bib yang berisi data bibliografis yang akan kita kutip di R Markdown itu harus ada di satu folder dengan file notebooknya. Jadi yang saya ada di sini adalah file notebooknya, kemudian ada file referensinya, kemudian kita juga perlu style sitiran yang akan kita pakai. Misalnya tadi Joy mencontohkan APA dan Unified Style Sheet for Linguistics. Jadi kita juga bisa mendownload style itu dengan menuju ke Chrome di Zotero Style Repository. Jadi ini adalah Zotero Style Repository. Bapak Ibu teman-teman tinggal Google saja dan akan muncul ini nanti. Jadi kita bisa cari misalnya Unify Style Sheet begitu. Kita klik kanan di sini, klik kanan, kemudian copy link address, ya. Karena kita mau download style ini di art, kita kembali ke art studio dan kita bisa download ini. File, kemudian kita simpan sebagai link.csl. CSL itu artinya Citation Style Language. Ya, jadi kita download itu dan simpan di satu folder dengan notebooknya. Ya, sudah ada di sini. Kalau ini diklik, tampilannya akan seperti ini. Jadi ini adalah gaya dari linguistik, Unified Style Sheet for Linguistics. Kemudian untuk menyitir, kita perlu menulis seperti ini di bagian metadata notebook, ya. Ini adalah metadata dari R notebook yang dibatasi dengan tanda ini, garis tiga ini. Jadi kita perlu kasih tahu R, halo R, file CSL-nya adalah link.csl. Kemudian file bibliografinya diambil dari file referensi.bib, ya, diambil dari sini, ya. Setelah kita memberitahu R soal ini, dia akan bisa berkoneksi nanti dengan style-nya dan juga referensi.bib. Dan untuk mengutip, misalnya kita perlu nambahkan F gitu. Karena ini kalimat pertama dari tentang X. Kemudian kalau kita mau mengutip dengan nama penulis ada di dalam kurung, kita perlu buat tanda kotak itu, kemudian kasih add, kemudian kita cari di sini yang kita ingin kutip misalnya. Dan ini memang tidak, saya belum tahu seperti yang LaTeX saya tunjukkan. I think you can do that directly while you write aja finding the author. But I need to switch Windows for that. Jadi kita copy di sini. Oh sorry, kita ini klik kanan, copy, kemudian kita paste di bagian sini. Ini kalimat pertama tentang X dalam kurung Kaufman 90. Kalau untuk menambahkan halaman, kita bisa beri koma dan 30. Ya, ini code ini perlu kita pelajari, ya, idenya. Tapi saya akan tunjukkan saja lebih awal, di awal secara sekilas apa yang bisa dilakukan. Kemudian kita bisa preview seperti tadi, tampilkan pratinjaunya, klik preview, dan jadi muncul sitirannya. Ini kalimat pertama tentang AIDS, kemudian di bawahnya otomatis muncul Kaufman ini. Jadi di bawah sini saya berikan penanda seperti ini, daftar pustaka, dan R nantinya akan otomatis memasukkan data bibliografis itu sebagai daftar pustaka di bawah, ya. Ya, dan kemudian kita juga bisa menyitir kita juga bisa menyitir dengan menghilangkan dengan nama penulis ada di luar tapi di dalam kurung hanya tahun kemudian halamannya. Kita bisa sitir seperti ini kalimat kedua oleh Kaufman, dan memang ini kita perlu lihat, ya, kadang-kadang kita harus ingat juga nama penulisnya, Kaufman dan Rosso. Oke, okay, Kaufman dan Rosso, itu, ya. Kemudian masih add, tapi sebelum add kita kasih strip, artinya kita tidak ingin nama penulisnya muncul, begitu. Oh sorry. Kita kutip lagi ini, citation key-nya, istilahnya ini adalah citation key, sorry saya lupa bilang itu. Ini yang penting untuk kita kutip di R Markdown notebook ya, Cites yang key, nah, kunci untuk menyitir informasi bibliografis tersebut ya, seperti ini. Ini kalimat kedua oleh Kaufman dan Russo tahun 90, halaman anggaplah 31. Kita preview lagi, dia akan muncul. Ini adalah kalimat kedua oleh Kaufman dan Russo 1931. Dan untuk menambahkan multiple author, kita bisa pisahkan masing-masing citation key itu dengan titik koma seperti ini. Dan kita juga bisa tambahkan misalnya lihat bla 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 untuk lebih rinci. Atau kita tambahkan halaman setelah itu misalnya 45. Kemudian kita preview lagi ya di bagian ini. Ini pernyataan tentang bla 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 bla, lihat halaman 45 untuk dirinci. Dan daftar pustaka akan otomatis terupdate selama kita kerja di Arloto. Jadi kalau Bapak Ibu ada perubahan daftar pustaka nantinya, tentunya kita harus mengulang kembali untuk mengekspor file itu, file notebook itu ke dalam Word. Ya, saya pikir untuk menyetir sudah. Coba kita need to Word, kita ekspor ini ke Word. Jadi ini dia tampilannya. Tentunya kita perlu pengaturan yang lebih banyak lagi terkait nama dan segala macam. Tapi idenya kan hanya mengutip di Arnold. Jadi ini ada kalimat pertama tentang X bla 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 tahun, code R, output dari code-nya daftar pustaka. Dan tentunya tujuan kita menggunakan either LaTeX ataupun R Markdown beda-beda. Dan memang tingkat kesulitannya sama-sama sulit. Jadi LaTeX juga sulit, saya belum pernah belajar. Kemudian R Markdown juga lumayan, kita harus menghafal workflow-nya seperti apa. Tapi saya pikir itu bisa dilakukan. We can learn everything if we want and if we need that, either LaTeX or R Markdown. Dan tergantung juga goal-nya apa. Ya, karena saya lebih banyak menulis paper dengan berisi banyak code, jadi R Markdown notebook lebih cocok untuk itu. Dan memang kita di sini, saya dan Jo memberikan option tools yang bisa Bapak Ibu gunakan. I think saya pikir itu sekian ulasan ringkas. Jo, I'm done. It's 5.
I don't know if we have more time. I did see maybe there were two questions with you, Katharina. Do we have time to respond to those questions?
Yes, Ibu Yanti, do we still have time for the
Q&A? Yes. I think so. We can, okay. As long as the speakers have time.
Yeah, well, I can keep it brief. I saw two questions that were written. One was Mendeley and Zotero, as Gede also mentioned, and the other was about backing up your database to online. So I was doing just a bit of research while Gede was talking. So the main difference between Zotero and Mendeley, they're basically the same program. The main difference is that Zotero is created by a nonprofit organization and all of its coding is open source. And so you know that it will always be free. And you know that people are not going to use that data to try to make money off of you or whatever else, where Mendeley is owned by Elsevier, which is a large publishing corporation. And so they're not open source. And there's been some speculation about why do they want this data. So I think that's the main reason why a lot of people prefer Zotero to Mendeley. But in terms of its function, it seems that both of them have very similar functions and you can use either in very similar ways. The other question about backing up was on can you back up your Zotero to the web so that you don't lose your information. So if I looked up the information about this, and Zotero in the preferences has a... You can't do this, so I can't put it lower on my screen at the moment, but it has a sync tab. And here is where you can set up an account on the Zotero website, a free account, where all of your metadata will sync. And that should be for any references. Everything should be able to sync there as long as you have internet access, and you can set up your account there. It also offers file syncing. So this is when you have a PDF that's also in your Zotero database, not just the information, the metadata about the reference. So you can also set up for syncing accounts, but that's limited to 300 megabytes unless you pay for the service to be able to have more. So if you're having trouble just backing up your Zotero, it may be that you have too many PDFs and that it's going over the 300 megabytes. So you might want to check that, or consider paying for the subscription account if you really want to use that. But I typically don't keep my PDFs in Zotero. I don't really find it very useful. I usually keep it in a separate folder anyway, so I don't usually use that. Hide, do you want to mention anything about those two topics?
Yeah, betul. It's right what you said. Saya tidak mengupload PDF ke Zotero server, only bibliographic information. So that's why you don't lose your space. Kita tidak akan kehilangan space kalau kita hanya meng-synchronize informasi bibliografis. Dan well, someone say that yeah, it's hard. R is hard. Kita hanya ingin menunjukkan bahwa kita bisa melakukan itu di R, dan apabila orientasi penelitian kita lebih pada kuantitatif dan banyak coding, itu sangat membantu. Dan memang kurva pembelajarannya cukup terjal ya untuk itu. Dan untuk Mendeley dan Zotero ya, open source basically.
Yeah, I think all of these things are hard. We show it very quickly, but that doesn't mean it's easy. I've been using LaTeX for maybe 5 years and I'm still learning, I'm still sometimes frustrated with it. So it will be hard if you choose to use it, but there are some benefits. So you need to decide if it's worth your time to get those benefits out of learning how to use this program.
Then someone said that the preview is not shown for the R. Mungkin karena preview-nya itu pop up dari HTML.
Yeah, sorry about the screen share. It wasn't working the way it was when we practiced this.
Okay. Are there questions? Well, it's already... Five minutes past four. Ibuyanti, shall we close this session, or do you want to say?
Maybe we can take one quick question.
Okay.
If any of the participants would like to ask questions.
There was one more question that just came up.
Okay.
How can our article automatically be inserted in Google Scholar so it can be used by others? Do you know the answer to this? Where does Google Scholar get their information from?
How can our it depends if you your article get indexed by Google Scholar. Like Linguistic Indonesia is indexed by Google Scholar, and at some point, if like say in repository of a university, you made your thesis closed access, it will not be available on Google Scholar, for instance. Dan ada beberapa hal yang tidak bisa terindex oleh Google Scholar, mungkin karena mereka meng-close code-nya, jadi Google Scholar tidak bisa membacanya, tapi ya, yeah, I don't know. It's Google does that automatically, I think. I don't know how does it work.
Okay. Ada lagi pertanyaan?
Di chat box ada tuh, how to connect Zotero to Microsoft Word.
Oh.
I mean, that's the part I did very quickly in English. Maybe today you can talk about Indonesian, where that download it.
Yeah. We'll do that. Cool. Jadi teman-teman, Bapak Ibu bisa di Google Zotero Word plugin. Jadi di sini ada Zoom. Di sini ada get started with this plugin, check out the following link. Jadi teman-teman bisa install ini Word plugin supaya bisa terhubung Word dan Zotero. Jadi tidak hanya Microsoft Word, bisa LibreOffice, dan saya pikir 2 tahun lalu mulai hubungan antara Zotero dan Google Docs terjalin 2018. Jadi teman-teman bisa kerja online di Google Docs, ambil kutipan dari Zotero, ya luar biasa. Jadi harus install Word Processor plugins.
There's no more question, right, in the list? Yeah.
Okay. Well, I think this is the end of our meeting today. I would like to thank Joy, yeah, for sharing with us and also Gede, for sharing with us a practical way of finding publications and managing references. Well, thank you for your time today, and I also would like to thank all participants who have joined our meeting today, and also to Ibu Yanti. Ibu Yanti, do you want to say a word or two to close this session?
Okay, thank you, Ibu Katrin. Thank you, Joy and Gede, again, for sharing a lot of new things here, I guess, for most of the participants here, because, you know, we can see from the questions they ask and their comments in the chat box. So, in 1 hour, we cannot cover everything. There are things which are unclear. And if you miss some parts of the presentation, you can always go to the YouTube. There is a link. So this is a live. This is live in on YouTube. So you can go to Atmajaya's YouTube, and then you can search. And also, there is an evaluation form, which we hope you can help fill out so that we know how to provide better event in the future. And then if you have any suggestions or any comments, just let us know. Thank you again to all the participants for joining us today, and hope to see you guys in our upcoming events. We are planning to have like a series of 2 talks at the end of June and early July, but we are still looking for some dates and have some discussion. So I'll keep you, PKBB will keep you updated on this. Okay, thank you, and see you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Yanti. Thank you, Gede. Thank you,
Katrina.
Thank you, all the participants. Terima kasih.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.